MLB This Week. It's the MLB This Week podcast. Dirt holds up a baseball game. Cuba's still defecting. And Nails comes clean, all on this edition of MLB This Week podcast. And hello, everyone. Welcome to MLB This Week. It's your weekly podcast talking all about baseball, some of the stories you may have missed. My name is Rich.
And I'm Gary.
And hello, Mr. Gary Mack. Welcome to another edition of MLB This Week.
Well, hello to you, Mr. Rich. And another good week. Lots of stories out there. Some crazy stuff going on. And you just never know. Oh, it's a kind of a sad week, the way the Mets are playing lately here in New York, but maybe they can put it together. But boy, they got a tough road to hoe now. The Cubbies are coming into town, and then they got to play the Marlins, who they're fighting for second place for. And then it's the Nationals again for four, who they are playing tonight and could be swept by them. And went to Washington three games out, and maybe leaving there six games out of first place. So not a good space of time for the New York Mets.
Yeah, no, indeed. And as we talked about the last couple podcasts, as the season continues on and we get closer to the All-Star break, the races get even better. So I'm really looking forward to the second half. It's been a wild first half, as you said. Plenty of news to talk about, and every week we do this show, I kind of think, is there ever going to be a week where we're going to have to dig for stories, we're going to have to, open a book and get to page 300 to get a story for this show, but it never seems to happen. In fact, most of the time, we can't cover all of the stories that we want to each week.
Yeah, or else we'd be doing a two-hour show, but try to keep it down to a minimum length. So lots of stories out there, Rich, and you know, we try to get the commonplace to the ridiculous on this show.
That's for sure. And one of the stories that was breaking as we were doing our podcast last week, we didn't get to, but before I forget to get to it again this week, I wanted to make sure our listeners heard our take on it. Of course, Pete Rose being retired by the Cincinnati Reds, his famous number 14, finally retired officially and formally by the Cincinnati Reds, a sold-out Great American Ballpark. It was a three-day weekend celebration, approved by Major League Baseball, by the way. And he got some good press after this, Gary. I think a lot more people were on the bandwagon to let Pete Rose into the Hall of Fame and back into baseball. So we'll have to see how much weight this carries for him from this great weekend he had just last weekend over there in Cincinnati.
You're right, Rich, and it's about time that they did it and about time that baseball allowed them to do it. And look, we all know the problems. We've discussed it here a million and one times, but no more deserving a person than Pete Rose, who have his number retired and get into the Cincinnati Reds Hall of Fame. And as you said, Rich, with the sellout crowds, I think it just shows you how much that city still loves their favorite son.
Yes, and the only player invited that could not make the festivities was Joe Morgan. He couldn't make the game. He's very sick. Very bad health problems. In fact, he's awaiting a bone marrow transplant. So, what a shame for Joe Morgan. Of course, his number 8 is retired by the Cincinnati Reds. And that Cincinnati Red machine was really something in the early to mid-70s.
They certainly were. Couldn't stand them. But they were something to behold, Rich. With that whole team now, as you say, Morgan and Pete Rose and George Foster and Johnny Bench, of course, and Tony Perez, They were a juggernaut, for sure.
Yes, they were. Rose was the 20th player to wear the number 14, getting it as a rookie way back in 1963. Kurt Flood wore that jersey in 1957, and you'd have to go way back to Don Zimmer to see who had it before him. He wore the number 14 jersey back in 1962. So officially now, no other Red will get a chance to wear the number 14 out in Cincinnati, and we're really happy about that.
Yeah, that's always quite an honor, and sometimes you have to wonder whether or not getting into the team's Hall of Fame is more of an honor than getting into the Baseball Hall of Fame. In some instances, it is, because, you know, it just shows you that team and that city loved you. But of course, the whole goal is to get into Cooperstown and the National Baseball Hall of Fame.
That's for sure. So we'll keep our eyes out for that. See how far Pete can get into the mainstream, so to speak. Get a little more support out there, and maybe we'll see that happen. If not this season, of course, maybe even next season. But we're going to jump right into our stories now, and we'll take some of the standings towards the end of the show this week. And, Gary, you have the first story up about a chunk of dirt holding up a game, an interesting topic here. I didn't hear about this one this past week.
Well, Rich, this is kind of a weird thing. During the game between the Diamondbacks and the Colorado Rockies on Sunday, play was stopped in the bottom of the fifth inning when a large piece of dirt mysteriously appeared on the mound. It wasn't actually all that mysterious. I mean, the mound is made out of dirt, so you would expect it, but for a few minutes, and I don't have a video of it, but for a few minutes, everybody acted like it was a foreign object. I mean, it's a clump of dirt that somehow formed and broke off on the mound. It was bizarre. The umpire poked at it with his foot a few times to make sure it was dead, but the players wouldn't get very close to it. They were standing away from the harmless chunk of dirt like they would, like they were afraid it would suddenly transform into some kind of monster or something and eat them. Maybe it's like that Geico glob commercial they were afraid of, you know? It was Gene Segura who finally had the courage to meet the mysterious chunk of dirt head-on. When the umpire called for the grounds crew, he stepped on it, looked down, and stomped it with his foot. He stomped on it again, kicked it with the side of his shoe, and then shoved off his devil-may-care attitude by picking it up and slamming it back into the ground. So they were able to maintain decorum and start the game again. But if you watch the video, it's a funny sight to see all of these people around this clump of dirt and not knowing what to do with it.
Yeah, it almost seems like a picture from Mars, the the picture that we were showing on the podcast. But, yeah, I guess you kind of wondered where it came from and why it dislodged out of the mound. And I guess it's one of those things where it's hard to keep that mound so manicured. But, yeah, you would think that by now the groundskeepers would just come out and have done something with it. But as you said, yeah, what an odd sight there.
Yeah, certainly was. And even funnier was the reaction of the umpires and the players. So, but again, there's always something weird in baseball going on, right?
So a clump of dirt causes a delay of game, almost like a rain delay there.
Yep.
Very interesting story.
Well, you know, as we say, there's always something wacky that you can find.
That's for sure. And a quick update to our story from last podcast about the Second Amendment night out there at the minor league stadium in Battle Creek, Michigan. All went well, so we didn't hear not one problem happening during the evening. Many people taking advantage of that, so I wanted to give our listeners an update again on that Second Amendment night over there in Battle Creek, Michigan. The Battle Creek Bombers, I believe their name is. was a successful night out there in Battle Creek. So I was glad to hear that.
Nobody got shot.
And nobody was afraid to to get out of line either, because you know, people were packing there.
That's right.
So I might have kept a little bit of more decorum.
Yeah.
Well, one player not keeping so much decorum was only a few days ago playing for the Cuban national team, which is participating in its first string of regular season professional games in the United States since 1960. The team, which hosted the Tampa Bay Rays in March, in what was to be the first time that a U.S. Major League Baseball team played on Cuban soil, the Cuban national team returned the favor, playing here in the States. But believe it or not, even though the friendliness of Cuba and the United States is going on right now, the Cubans had a player missing. Once the game was over, it was noted that 24-year-old outfielder Lazaro Ramirez had disappeared. He is believed to have defected to the United States, and this happened actually not during a game or after it, but pregame. He was out shopping, and he actually was discovered missing by the team. So it's believed that he did walk away from his Cuban national team. And by the way, Gary, those Cuban nationals, they haven't lost a game yet in this 20-game tour that will take them up through Quebec, even through July 2nd. So the only loss they've had so far is one outfielder, a 24-year-old, who decided to defect.
Yeah, maybe he liked the mall, you know? He maybe got locked into the mall or something.
Yeah, really. This story just broke today, so we're waiting on an update to see where this Ramirez will surface. Of course, he'll probably be looking to play for a major league team. Who knows? Maybe he has an offer already. He was batting 304 before he disappeared, and he will now join a group that includes White Sox slugger Jose Abreu, of course, New York Mets outfielder Yonas Cespedes, and Yankees closer Aroldis Chapman, who all have defected from Cuba to play this great game of baseball in the United States.
Actually, they defected for the big bucks, but that's okay.
Yeah, if you can get it, why not?
Yeah, right.
So an interesting story there, where the Cubans, though friendly with the U.S. now, they still have to make that jump sometimes to get their freedom. Well, you have the freedom of listening to great baseball talk radio shows, and we'd like to tell you where you could tune into a few of them. Our director of programming, Vice President Gary Mack, would like to tell you all where you can listen to some of those shows.
Well, Rich, if you like baseball like we do, you can find it at baseballtalkradio.com. There's 30-plus podcasts there, and they range from fantasy baseball to Canadian baseball, Japanese baseball, and we've got the teams covered. We've got the Phillies. Rich does a great job with that. I've got my Mets podcast, his minor league podcast. We got the Brewers, the Giants, the Dodgers, you name it. It's there on Baseball Podcast. There's even a podcast on groundskeeping. So if you're looking for a great podcast and great baseball talk, go to baseballtalkradio.com, the home of great baseball talk shows.
Yes, indeed. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And congratulations on the Vice President of Internet Programming there.
Well, thank you, Mr. President. Or Mr. Chairman, should I say.
Yep, so stop on over there. You can listen to podcasts all the time, 24 hours a day there at baseballtalkradio.com. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can follow us at MLBThisWeek. Can find out our latest shows and some of the tweets that we make about the stories that we'll be doing this week. So check it out on Twitter, MLB This Week. Gary, you have the next story up on the show tonight, all about some future game rosters.
Well, you know, Rich, part of the All-Star game is the whole experience. And, of course, a major part of that is the futures game, which is usually minor league players that are going to be the future stars, hopefully, of the major leagues. And they just announced the rosters. And, of course, the team is broken up into a U.S. team and a world team. So the rosters just came out the other day, and I'll go through this quickly, if I may. The manager of the U.S. team is Trevor Hoffman, and one of his coaches is Billy Beane, not the general general manager of the Athletics, but the other Billy Beane, the VP for Social Responsibility and Inclusion out of the Office of the Commissioner. He's a coach. Kirk Champion is the bullpen coach. Kirk Champion is the minor league coordinator for the Chicago White Sox. Mark Loretta is the bench coach. Fred McGriff, the crime dog, is the first base coach. Of course, we all know him from his Atlanta Braves and days. And Mark Pryor is the pitching coach. Gary Templeton is the third base coach. Jim Thome, former Philly, he's the hitting coach. JoJo Tarantino is the trainer, and over in the world team, the manager is Moises Alou. Third base coach is Jose Leger. He is the manager of the Columbia Fireflies. Ever McGallanis is the first base coach. Luis Ortiz is the hitting coach. Curtis Pride is a coach, and Luis Rojas is another coach, bench coach. And he is the manager of the St. Lucie Mets. David Rosario, the pitching coach for the South Bend Cubs, is the pitching coach for the world team. Luis Sierra is the bullpen coach. And Joe Benji is the trainer for the world team. And I'm just perusing some of these players and stuff. And just a lot of top prospects and guys you would expect. Danby Swanson of the Braves, who was the big pick a couple of years ago, last year, I believe, the number one pick, was traded to the Braves. He's going to be on the squad. Dominic Smith, the number one pick of the Mets a couple of years ago, he's going to be on that squad as well. This is the U.S. team now. Couple of pitches, Anthony Banda, the D-backs, a high pick. Prospect, Jeff Hoffman of the Rockies. And you can find the list online. Outfielders, Andrew Benintendi of the Red Sox, another top prospect of the Boston Red Sox. He is on the American team. And on the world team is just a mixture of everybody, as you would expect. The Giants' Adalberto Mejia is on the team, another top prospect. Along with Gary Sanchez, a prospect of the New York Yankees, that they're very high on him. And Dilson Herrera from the New York Mets, he's on the world team as well. And I find that a little odd because, and in the case of Gary Sanchez, I believe as well, they both have some major league time. Not too much, but a little bit. And then world team, the outfield is Jorge Bonifacio, a top pick of the Royals. And the list is goes on, and you can find it online if you're interested in the futures game. And always an interesting game to see some of the guys of the future. You can see them now while they're young.
Very cool. And I guess that is July 10th. At Petco Park in San Diego, that game is going to be held, and very cool. It's always a great time to see, as you said, the prospects, and what a great draft it was a couple of weeks ago. We saw a lot of the top talent in the nation get drafted, so here's yet another opportunity for viewers to check in on some of the top talent now playing, as you said, in AAA and Double A, places like that. And it's just going to be a great game. And how about some of that money some of those guys signed for a couple weeks back? That was amazing to me.
Some amount. still not the top dollars like some of the players we hear of getting, but Mets signed their number 2 second round pick today, and he was in the College World Series. And in fact, they have a 5th or a 6th round player still playing, and they're playing tonight as Coastal Carolina plays Arizona for the it's a winner take all game tonight for the College World Series championship. But I think the second round pick to the Mets signed for $909,000. Now, they have put limitations on the amount of money you can spend, and I think it's kind of a good thing in a way, Rich, because it could get crazy with just signing some of these guys, and they're unproven, and it's such a crapshoot too, whether they're going to pan out to really sign them for huge and huge amounts of money. So I think that putting a nice cap on it really did the trick.
Yeah, and we're talking $5 to $6 million for an 18-year-old coming out of high school, and as you said, they're unproven, Gary, but hey, that's a good motivator for somebody in high school. If you're just getting into a freshman or a sophomore and you have some talent, imagine what a $5 or $6 million signing would do for you. So that's a little incentive for these younger guys that are maybe thinking about a baseball career, and if they have the talent, then why not go for it?
But it is so difficult, Rich. You know that. It is so difficult to make that leap and really to continue. I don't know if I told this story on this show, but my wife and I go to a single A game, a short season in Brooklyn here in Brooklyn, New York, an affiliate of the Mets, the Brooklyn Cyclones, and we went the other night and to look out there and see these young guys. First off, it's exciting. They're 18 to 23 years old, and they're playing, professional baseball. And I was lucky I could get out of my own way when I was 21, 22. These guys are living in a strange city, and they're on their own, and they're playing professional baseball. But when you think about it, you look out, and you think about it, that 80 to possibly 90% of them will wash out in the next couple of years, 1 or 2 years. And but again, they did fulfill part of their dream. They got to play professional baseball. Maybe not make it to the majors, because again, it is so difficult. It's a grind, but at least they can always say they played professional baseball. But it's a sobering thought when you sit there and you think that 85 to 90% of these guys, and as we're watching them, we're thinking, wow, that kid's got some talent. It's just the jump is so great that it really is amazing.
Yes, it is. And we encourage all of our listeners out there, especially, of course, you in the United States, get out there and check out a double A or a single A game if you haven't been in a while. And I'm due for another trip myself soon, Gary. Very interesting the way they do everything at the stadium. A little bit different than Major League, more focused on the family, fun, things like that. But baseball is a serious business, and you can see that on the field. So check it out, some single A, double A, or even triple A baseball this summer around you. And Gary, that leads us up to our next story. Some people chasing for tickets up in the New York area will have a familiar place to go to, as in this story from the New York Times specifically. After years of feuding, the Yankees and StubHub announced an agreement this Monday under which the company will become the team's official ticket reseller. But this time it will include caveats that includes a floor on how much tickets can be discounted. Now, that's one of the things that I really liked about StubHub. You could go on there and buy a ticket for $3 or $5 if that's all the person wanted to sell them for. But now the Yankees have instituted a few caveats to that. So you probably won't see those tickets for $3 or $5 on StubHub for the Yankees.
Go ahead, Rich.
I was just going to say, struggling on the field, and attendance has dropped by over 65,000 fans from this point a year ago. So it's going to be interesting to see what and if this does help them at all.
Well, you know, the stupid part about it is they're just being snobs about the whole thing. They don't want – they're selling the ticket anyway. So they're getting their full cost of money. But they're so afraid that some, you know, them CTC behind home plate, the cushion, the cushy ones that go for, I don't know, $1,000 or something.
Yeah, the overpriced ones.
Yeah. They don't want somebody buying them for $150, and God forbid that they're not, you know, the type of people that they want sitting there, you know. And they're afraid that somebody that paid $1,000 is going to complain. Well, that's tough. That's then you sell your tickets on StubHub as well. Like you said, you look, see, because you can get a buy on these things. Then either lower your ticket prices or to combat it, so StubHub doesn't have a marketplace. If you're selling your tickets at a reasonable price, people may buy them. But the Yankee fans won't now, probably, because they don't want to go because the team is lousy this year. And the Mets fans will do that, too, if the Mets continue to struggle. I mean, they'll be – I always say, you know, I'll go to a game because it's less traffic than if they're that, you know, if they really get bad. But people don't think that way, and especially in New York. But this is all about snobbery, and we went over this before – that they don't want riffraff, and they said this. I mean, the vice president of the Yankees said this on a TV show, a radio show. He said they don't want the riffraff sitting down there, and they figure the riffraff is going to get it from StubHub. So,
yeah, and the Yanks tried their own ticket agency in the first part of this year. That didn't go over too big. And StubHub refused to have people print out their tickets at home, which I'm not a fan of printing my own tickets at home. I like to save my stubs, but I have in the past when it becomes convenient to print at home, of course, rather than go up to the stadium and wait in a long line. So it'll be interesting to see. The new service doesn't start until July 7th for games that will begin on July 15th. But I'm not a big fan of that artificial floor, so to speak. To me, that is not what StubHub was meant to be.
Right.
StubHub was basically a pretty good place where you could pick up some tickets at a real cheap price as long as somebody was willing to sell them. So it'll be interesting.
I'm sorry, what did they say that floor was?
The floor pricing would be a 50% discount on the price of an individual ticket at the full season ticket rate. So that's their floor, which doesn't seem to be that bad. But still, you can, as you said, those tickets are $1,000, $750 around the dugouts, things like that. Now you can pick them up for $350.
Still a lot of money.
And if that sounds like a bargain, there's a bridge over there in Brooklyn.
And you know, I'm looking online here. McDonald's has got a 2-for-1. You buy one for $40 or something, you get the second one free.
So yeah, you can still find the bargains, even around New York.
Most certainly.
Very interesting there. We'll see where that takes us with Yankee baseball up there. And another stadium, old-time stadium, Tiger Stadium, is in the news this week.
Well, yeah, Rich. You know, I actually had to look at this twice because they started reading it. And I says, what are they doing to Tiger Stadium? And then I realized that they're playing Comerica Park now. But they used to be Tiger Stadium, the old Tiger Stadium on the corner of Michigan and Trumbull in Detroit. And originally it was Navin's Field back in the, well, God knows, the 1900s or something. And there was a group that actually volunteered and maintained the field. The city and the Tigers had let that area go. It was overgrown with weeds and everything. And volunteers got together and went and actually maintained it and played ball games there. But now the Police Athletic League is taking over the area, which is a good thing. Gonna, you know, put a nice little stadium and things there. But the bulldozers came to tear it up because they are going to put in an artificial turf. The people were not happy about this. 2,500-seat youth sports facility. And it includes the Detroit Police Athletic League offices. It will allow the PAL to increase its programming, which serves right now about 13,000 kids. And the new facility is expected to be open in June of 2017. Now, it's kind of a bittersweet thing for what I said, the Navin Field grounds crew, who was this volunteer group that took over the maintenance of the field. And they're happy that it's going to be used, but they're a little sad that they didn't keep the regular turf on the field instead of going to a synthetic turf. But PAL officials say they'll have the field open during specific times, and it's going to host many different events and many different athletic contests. So thus they need the synthetic turf, or else it would just wear down, and the maintenance would be incredible. So they're doing some good, though, resurrecting the old stadium, if you will, that was torn down. The land is still there, and they're resurrecting that. At least we get to preserve some of it. It's going for a good cause.
Yeah, and a lot more people will be able to use the field. It'll be in a lot better shape than it has been in the last few years. Of course, usually when ESPN broadcasts a game from Detroit, they'll go to a shot with some people playing some baseball on the old site. But it was basically a field that was nothing more than an abandoned field at that point.
Yeah, exactly.
So I know in our big cities where we're from in the Northeast, like Shea Stadium is part of the parking lot now of Citi Field,
right.
As is Philadelphia's Veterans Stadium. There's a little marker where home plate was when they steamrolled over that and made it a parking lot. But, you know, a lot of these old-time places, they get repurposed. So maybe now with Detroit building that stadium and, you know, putting it to good use, it'll even get more of a great use to it.
Yeah, and as I said, the only problem that the group had, the volunteer group, was that they would have liked to have seen the regular real grass stay there, because that's the tradition of the area. But, you know, for the events they're going to use it for, you really do need the synthetic turf, and that's what they're going to put in.
Very cool. So I can't wait to see that come to fruition there in Detroit. Well, let's take a look around the league here as we get into the podcast here. Only a couple of stories left in the show. Great time to talk about who's got the lead. And in the American League East, it's the Baltimore Orioles. Nobody really picked them on the radar. Still a commanding lead with 47 wins and 37 losses. 8-2 in their last 10, 7-game winning streak. Wow, they were riding high, and they just hit their 55th home run of the month of June. I believe that set a new record for MLB homers in June, and we still have another day to go in June, so they could add to that list. Orioles really with some power, 55 home runs in June.
And like you said, Rich, nobody really expected them. 5.5 game lead now over Toronto and the Red Sox. So really doing a great job there. Buck Showalter really getting his troops going there. And The Yankees 9.5 back, and Tampa Bay is bringing up the rear at 14. And another team, Rich, over in the American League Central, the Cleveland Indians, 6-game lead over the Kansas City Royals. Who would have expected that?
Yeah, the Royals are coming back. They're 6 games back in the plus column. They're 4 games over 500. But, yeah, not a lot of people would have picked Cleveland to do much. I know my old podcast co-host who recently passed away, Jimmy, was a big Cleveland fan. So I'm not so sure that he's not looking down on them in disbelief either.
Yeah, that's for sure, because maybe this is Cleveland's year for everything, Rich, you know. With the Cavaliers winning the NBA championship, and they're just remarkable. They've won 11 in a row. They're having just an incredible season. And, you know, you got to like Terry Francona. It shows you how old I am. Yeah, he's a terrific manager, and they've got some good pitching, and they're healthy. That's the key to all of this, staying healthy. They've got to stay healthy the rest of the year, but they're building a cushion, and Detroit's sneaking back in. They could catch – they're only a game behind Kansas City, so they're quietly sneaking in. And then you look at the West, Rich, and Texas, they might be the best team in the American League.
Yeah, Texas really raised the bar when they picked up Cole Hamels, picked up a few other players. And, yeah, they tried to do a little bit what the Anaheim Angels were trying to do, but they seem like they're more successful at it so far, adding some big-name free agents with players they already had there in Texas, and they've turned it around. So going to be interesting to see the second half of the season with those Texas Rangers. And as you said, Gary, it's going to be a good race out there.
Yeah, 9.5 lead, game lead over second place Houston, who's really made a strong comeback after the terrible start that they had, 42-37. They're over 500, really doing a terrific job over there. And then, of course, that brings us to the Senior League, the National League. And, Rich, in the East, our teams are not faring too well lately.
No, not too bad. Of course, the Mets, they're still chasing the division-leading Washington Nationals. But, you know, it's still early in the season. We're almost up to the All-Star break, but they're keeping a pace at least, only 5 games back, along with the Miami Marlins. And I'm not too sure that the Washington Nationals might have missed a step or two. They're 3-7 in their last 10. They've had a few losses, so, you know, they're proving they're not invincible. Not unlike the Chicago Cubs over in the West, though, or the Central, rather, more West than Washington. 51-26 are the Cubs, and what a powerhouse juggernaut team they have.
They are unbelievable, and you know, I wouldn't be surprised if you looked at it and you see the Cubs and the Rangers in the World Series the way things are playing out here, and could very well be what happens. But as you say, Rich, we still got a while to go, so things can happen. But St. Louis is 10.5 back, Pittsburgh 14.5 back of Chicago. I don't think anybody's going to – they would have to have a major, major catastrophe happen, for them to get to lose that Central, I think, at this point. They're just they just get such a big cushion right now. And out West – oh, I'm sorry, Rich.
I was going to say Cubs, and they're guys that are on the bench waiting to get on the field and play – are almost like all-stars on that team. Very impressive, the Cubs. This might be the year that the curse is broken.
I'm not going to go that far yet, but...
let's go out to San Fran.
Yeah, San Fran. They're only 2 wins behind the record of the Cubs, so... they're doing it again in this even year, and you got to think about them, Rich. It's just amazing. And Dodgers are falling six games back, but it looks like they're in line for the wild card right now. But, wow, the job the Giants are doing, and it's almost like, Rich, that they get into the World Series, and then there's that hangover the next year. They just got to regroup. They're not as good. They regroup. They rebuild. They lose some guys. They add some guys. And it's all clicking so far. And, boy, getting them, if you get them into the playoffs, it's going to be. It's going to be an interesting playoff, let's just say that.
Very interesting indeed. And speaking of interesting, we're coming up on the 4th of July holiday. So this will probably be the last show before the 4th of July or after. I'm interested in seeing those nice 4th of July jerseys and hats they usually wear on the weekend for that nice holiday, of course. And, wow, the holidays are just starting to roll on, aren't they, Gary?
Yeah, they're certainly coming quick, Rich, and it's hard to believe that it's almost All-Star break, too. It's a mere 2 weeks away from, or 13 days away from tonight or so. Just unbelievable how fast it's coming.
Yes, indeed. And how about all those apparel changes that we've seen by the teams this year? Mother's Day, then there was Father's Day with the powder blue uniform. So this has been a real big season for uniform changes in baseball. I don't remember a year that has been this many coordinated changes as a league. We used to see this, you know, individually in different markets from time to time, but this year they really went whole hog to celebrate these holidays. And, of course, the Stars and Stripes uniforms are going to debut this weekend coming up for July 4th. And going to be a colorful bunch out there on the field.
It's all about the cash, Rich. You know, people will buy this stuff. And to paraphrase Field of Dreams, if you make it, they will buy it. So
that's for sure. And of course, celebrating the games out there in San Diego, we're going to have yellow and brown, their old yellow and brown type style jerseys they used to wear, and National and American coming up for the All-Star workout day. So yeah, there's going to be a ton of new jerseys and hats I think everybody's going to be on the hunt for.
Yeah, Rich, showing now the 4th of July Stars and Stripes caps from a new era. And it's all about the Benjamins.
Yeah.
That's what it is. You know, we had those caps last year for the All-Star game. They're going to have different caps this year for the All-Star game. You said they're going to have the style for the Home Run Derby is going to be the old San Diego Padres style. And then I believe they're also having another style. I'm trying to find it online for the All-Star game itself. Remember last year they had the style with well, let me show you. That was the style from last year. Yes, I know it's a Miami Marlins hat, but we went through this already. I lost the bet. My bad. Wear a hat. And that was the style last year. Trying to copy the old pillbox hats, I think. They should have just went to the pillbox hats. They were pretty cool looking. Pirates still wear them on a weekend, I think. But this year it's a little bit different, and I just can't find the picture right now.
They're going to be cool, that's for sure. I have the picture. Maybe I can put it up on for our viewers here. Let me quickly try here for you. Not sure. There she be. 2016 MLB All-Star Game uniform elements. So there's going to be some of what you see. There, I guess you could see it, Gary.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be very interesting to see all these different cool jerseys. And, of course, as you said, it's all about the money, millions of dollars spent on some of these things. And I'll probably be out there looking for a thing or two.
Yeah, or wait until it goes on clearance in August or September.
Exactly. Two weeks after, and you'll have the pick of the litter there, whatever you want.
That's right. Whatever's left over, MLB will be selling it. Or if you can wait a year and you really like the hat, they'll be on clearance. And nothing against the hat. It's just that's what happens.
And again, some of them do sell out. So if you're somebody that just must have it, don't wait around. Sometimes you can lose out on it. Well, Gary, somebody that lost a lot in the last few years, his name is Lenny Dykstra, and he's come out with a new book, House of Nails. It's set for publication on Tuesday, coming up right after the holiday here, and all about the dirt, so to speak. We were talking a little bit about it before we started the show, and you've heard a lot more about it than me. But Dykstra is going to explain how he started on steroids. Actually, when he was traded to the Phillies from the Mets, this is a quote. He said, quote, "So I said, I need to play. I finally got traded to the Phillies in 1989, and I'm 150, 140 pounds. So I knew." Phillies then general manager Lee Thomas said, "Look, we're going to give you 1990. You'll be our everyday guy." So that is what it took for Lenny Dykstra to look up somebody in the steroid business, and he actually thought about Ben Johnson from the Olympics in 1988. Actually, he was stripped of his gold medal from the 100-meter run, but he actually looked up a doctor in Mississippi and told him the same thing, that he needed steroids, he needed to get build up for this upcoming season for 1990 with the Phillies, and that's exactly what he did. He went out there, bulked up, and he claims that it worked. He says in 6 months or so, he was getting physically huge and needed to stay strong. So in 1990, he eventually led the NL in hits with 192, an on-base percentage of 418, and he ranked fourth in batting average at 325. So all of a sudden overnight, Lenny Dykstra became a superstar.
Well, what can I say? Lenny Dykstra was a good player. He probably could have been a better player without the steroids, but he's a head case. He's a real bad head case. And this is a guy that has been to jail, has committed frauds, has had multi-million dollar and lost it all, had a string of car washes. He's been arrested for breaking into people's houses and you know, almost like sleeping there because he didn't have a place to go. I mean, and some of the stuff coming out, it's already been discredited by people that work with him. You know, we get a lot of stories here about the 86 Mets that he tells in there. And, of course, he says that the manager was drunk all the time, Davey Johnson, and it interfered with what he was doing on the field. And that's been discredited by a number of the other players that said, yes, he liked to have a drink on the in the airport or on the plane and in the evening, but never during a game, and he was never drunk during a game. Lenny is a publicity seeker and he needs money, and he's so stupid that he's giving away all the things on the book. He's doing all kinds of interviews, but he's telling all the spicy stuff in the book. Usually you give one or two things out and say, oh, there's much more in the book, and then, you know, everybody wants to go buy it. Why buy it? He just listened to his interview. if you can get through how incoherent it is, you can find out that it's not worth really reading. And And a lot of this stuff is not true. And in fact, I'll give you an example of one thing that shows you how crazy this guy is. This guy had multi-million dollar, lost it all, fraud arrests, just, and the Mets had their 30-year reunion of the 86 Mets a couple of weeks ago, and he was there. And the story goes that he had a couple of the players that he talked to, the retired Mets, and he said, oh, give me all your pension money. Take it out of the Major League Baseball. Give it to me, and I'll earn you more money. Well, I'm sorry. I wouldn't give him a penny at this point. So you're going to risk your retirement fund? Of course, both of these players were kind and just said, oh, okay, Lenny, we'll look into it. We'll think about it. But there's no money going to Lenny Dykstra from a retirement fund. Because
I'll take a rain check on that, Lenny.
Yeah, I'll take a rain check, Lenny. I'd like to, but, you know, it's all tied up. So,
yeah, and even, even in the Pennsylvania area where his son, Cutter Dykstra, was in, I believe he still may be in the AAA or AA baseball, he used to sell sweets with him at the local ballparks, signing autographs, and you get to meet Lenny Dykstra. Oh, big deal. And, oh, by the way, it was like $200, $300 for this privilege, quote-unquote, to do this. And as you said, Gary, I wouldn't give him 10 cents.
Yeah, yeah, really. And it was a shame because he was a good ball player, but, you know, you wonder, was he always this kind of crazy, or was it the steroids that the put him over the top crazy or what? But some of the stories are disgusting, and just I haven't read the book, so you know, if you want to, but I've seen enough about it, seen enough interviews with him, and I'm not even going to waste my time, and I didn't even get a free copy, and I'm not even going to, if I did,
I wouldn't waste my time. Well, we're going to lead the podcast out this week, and I hope everybody has a great 4th of July holiday out there. And we're going to talk about something that you may be having over the 4th of July holiday, and that being one great burger.
Well, Rich, it wouldn't be a podcast without minor league food coming up on this. And the Akron Rubber Ducks have introduced the LeBlanc Burger. It's a nod to Akron native LeBron James. The LeBlanc burger is a bacon-stuffed burger topped with Middlefield cheddar cheese, wine, and gold slaw, and a championship onion ring on a Kaiser bun. The entree is served with a side of fries topped with salty curry powder. The new burger comes on the heels of the Cleveland Cavaliers winning the NBA championship, Cleveland's first title in major sports in 52 years. The extreme menu item will sell for $9.75. They apparently have a bunch of these kind of things. They have the Johnny Footlong, I guess, meaning Johnny Manziel when he was with the Cleveland Browns. And the Return of the King Burger, of course, LeBron James, when he came back to the Cavaliers. The other items that they have is the pineapple Terry Akron bowl. They're a teriyaki. Mm. It's Terry Akron bowl. A half pineapple hollowed out and stuffed with a stir fry mix and finished with a drizzle, just a drizzle, of teriyaki sauce. And the ugly duckling, 16 ounces of stout beer poured over 3 scoops of vanilla ice cream, topped with chocolate syrup and sprinkles, and that does it. I'm hungry. I'm out of here, Rich, and let's go eat.
And you said it. What a great burger that is after LeBron, and they might have to go find that burger soon because they just announced that LeBron is seeking free agency as of today, probably not staying with the Cavaliers, so bye-bye LeBron and bye-bye burger.
They'll have the bye-bye burger then, maybe.
Well, again, we want to wish everyone out there, our listeners, a happy 4th of July holiday. Make it a safe one. And we'll talk to you right after the holiday with our impressions of the 4th of July, the big celebrations, the uniforms, the caps, the whole nine yards. So we'll talk to you again later.
Bye-bye, everybody.